Hi, welcome to the 350th edition of the Shtick. We're now at the end of season 33. It's been an amazing journey having the Shtick running for this long, and the celebrations keep on going because we're having an election coming up very soon, and the political shtick is now in full swing. And to be our very special guest on this week's show, we have Mr. Josh Frydenberg, MP.
Nice to be with you, Henry.
And nice to see you.
Congratulations. 350 shows, 33 seasons. Amazing. And it's a real testament to your hard work.
And 9 years. Exactly 9 years.
And lots of shticks.
And who was the first presenter on our show?
Let me tell you, John Howard? I don't know.
Your father. Your father was the first presenter on the panel when we filmed at the RMIT studios.
There you go.
But you're here to speak to me about politics.
Absolutely. It's pretty exciting at the moment.
It is.
You know, it's going to be a close race, but certainly I'm picking up some very positive vibes on the ground about the need for change. And, you know, I'll go out and prosecute our case together with all my colleagues in the lower house as well as the Senate race.
And what do you think are the most essential crunchy bits of policy that you've got that are different from Labor? Because I think a lot of people are looking and they're sort of saying, yeah, there's a bit of difference, but what's really different?
Well, they can really trust us to fix the economy. I think that's what it comes down to. I mean, if you look at Labor, they have produced 12 out of 12 budget deficits, five under the Hawke-Keating era, and now the biggest five budget deficits under this government. The next two budgets they're promising are also going to be in deficit, whereas when we were in government during the Howard years, we produced 10 out of 12 budget surpluses. So that goes right to the heart of it. Who can bring the rising debt under control? Who can create jobs? Who can create some more business confidence? I mean, just earlier today, I've been sitting down with small business owners, and they're doing it tough, Henry, and they want some, you know, incentives. They want some people to get out there and to spruik the reason why our economy should be stronger than it is, and we're going to do that.
You think Joe Hockey's going to be a good treasurer?
I think he'll be a very good treasurer, and he has a big responsibility because we're going to face a massive budget black hole.
I think the thing that's really, really bothering most of the electorate is the thought of having Tony Abbott as Prime Minister.
Well, I disagree entirely. I think Tony Abbott has done an amazing job, Henry, as the leader of the opposition. I mean, let's not forget, when he came to power on the 1st of December 2009, around that period, he was well behind in the polls. And people were talking about Kevin Rudd ruling for decades. Well, that never happened because Labor stabbed him in the back, got rid of him. Julia Gillard turned out to be a disaster, and we've had a lot of tumultuousness in Canberra. And now we've got Kevin Rudd again, and he's no different to Kevin Rudd Mark I. And I think that's why people are desperate for a change. So Tony deserves a lot of credit. He's got a great narrative for the country about building our economy and making us stand tall on the world stage again. And I'm very confident that he'll lead us to victory on September the 7th.
I think he has really improved a lot. I've noticed his image has really propelled him to a statesmanship role.
Yeah.
You know, and so I just ask you that question because there is a lot of concern about him, but I think there's even more concern about Kevin Rudd.
Well, there's certainly a lot of concern about Kevin Rudd because, you know, the guy, he's more interested in tweeting selfies of himself, you know. I mean, but what it really happened that day that he tweeted a photo of having cut himself.
Yeah, I saw that.
Something
the Norman Gunston moment.
Yeah, Norman Gunston moment. But what happened that day, Henry, was that the unemployment numbers came out and our unemployment had risen. And it reached, for example, young people's unemployment, the highest in 15 years. Mm. And, you know, in places like Tasmania, unemployment was above 8%, in Queensland above 6%. And that was all overcome because people were more interested in the Prime Minister of a country tweeting a selfie. And so I think we've got to look over celebrity and look at policies and look at leaders' record. And that's why I think they're over Kevin Rudd.
I went to the launch last night of Kevin Eckendale, who's running against Michael Danby, who's coming on the show after you today. And he was talking a lot about the policy of the Liberal Party in regard to Israel.
Sure.
With the thought of Bob Carr being our foreign minister, saying that all the settlements were illegal. Mm. What's your opinion about that?
Oh, that was a ridiculous statement from Bob Carr. I mean, you know, he and Kevin Rudd have been a big disappointment when it comes to Israel, whereas Tony Abbott and Julie Bishop have stood tall. They've been consistent. They've had a well-argued cases. And what they can identify with Israel is that it's a country under siege. It's surrounded by enemies. Mm-hmm. And by people who are seeking to destroy it. And under those circumstances, it has to protect itself. And so the measures that Israel takes and arguably are always in self-defense. And what Bob Carr doesn't understand is that is the real essence of the security dilemma that Israel faces. I mean, you turn on the TV and what are we greeted with? Hundreds of dead in Cairo. We're hearing about 100,000 plus dead in Syria. You know, we're seeing great schisms within the Islamic world at the moment. Mm. This is a very difficult time for a country like Israel, which is surrounded by this, you know, uncertainty. But at the same time, Israel is a proud democracy, a strong economy, well known for innovation, and it has nearly as many Nobel Prize winners as Australia. And it's, you know, a fraction of the age. So it's a great story that Israel is. And unfortunately, Bob Carr and Kevin Rudd, they just don't get it.
Because at the moment, there is a peace process going on. And it's very difficult for Israel to be negotiating with the Palestinians when there's all this going on around them. Mm. So that's a real dilemma. And they're letting go of these prisoners who've got blood on their hands. So there is a lot of problem in the Middle East at the moment, which isn't really our concern directly, but indirectly we have to have some sort of a say in it.
Well, the reason why Tony Abbott and Julie Bishop support Israel is because they understand that it's in Australia's national interest, that they're actually siding with a country who shares its democratic values. Mm. I mean, that's what's at the heart of it, Henry, is that Israel has democratic values, which Australia shares. And that's why Israel and the United States are also great friends. So, look, the peace process is ultimately what needs to happen, and we need a two-state solution in the Middle East. It's what is in the best interests of both Israel and their Palestinian neighbours.
And there's but it shouldn't be at any price. There's a controversy with the Greens' preferences now. Mm. Where do you stand with that?
Oh, we are not preferencing the Greens. We believe that the Greens are a much more radical party than, let's say, Labor is. And we've seen that in the last few years of this hung parliament. And the fact that the Greens have been in coalition with the Labor Party has made policy even worse than it otherwise would have been under the Labor Party. So they don't deserve our preferences.
And the last question I wanted to ask you was about school funding and security at schools.
Well, the Coalition's made a very important announcement here. It's proposing $18 million over 3 years for safer, secure schools. So schools that are in danger and under threat will be able to get funding under a Coalition government, not just for infrastructure, but also for paying for the guards. Now, they're not just Jewish schools. There are a number of other schools, like Islamic schools and other schools, that are also equally under threat. But Jewish schools have certainly been in need. And we don't want to see a repeat of what happened in Toulouse in France, where tragically 3 school children and 1 school teacher were killed. And only months before, Henry, that school, that Jewish school, had removed the guards because it couldn't afford to pay for them. And then that tragedy followed. So this is a very positive announcement by the Coalition. And George Brandis and Chris Fine and, of course, Tony Abbott should be congratulated.
Well, I'd like to congratulate you for finding the time to be on the Shtick. It's been really great to have
to see
you on board.
Henry.
There are so many more questions I'd like to ask you. We've got a list of things that we'd like to discuss with you. But at this stage, we'll have to say farewell, and we'll be back with Michael Danby after the break, and he'll be talking about Liberal...
Forget the Greens.
Forget the Greens. Well, there you go. There's politics for you. See you after the break.